from the studios on the Daytona State College East Campus.
Hello, welcome to the Small Business Hotline. I'm your host, Ned Harper, and tonight's show is on the franchise opportunity. Is a franchise a good business decision? And who is the right franchise owner? The Small Business Development Centers throughout Florida help clients get information necessary to enjoy business success. Tonight, we have two franchise specialists that assist entrepreneurs to navigate the complex process of evaluating the franchise decision. Roger Greenwald, certified business analyst with the SBDC at UCF Orlando, and Marshall Reddy, principal for FranNet in Jacksonville. This is a live call-in show, so call 1-800-901-9238 for answers to your questions about franchise opportunities. Gentlemen, what is franchising and what does it really mean to buy and own a franchise business?
Well, Ned, I guess I can lead off with that one. Actually, franchising is not a new concept. Actually, it's a marketing strategy, if you will, that started in the 1850s with Isaac Singer as a way to increase sales and distribution of his sewing machines. It's come a long way since then. But fundamentally, franchising is where the franchisor or the owner of a product or a service will give you the right, the franchisee, to use his process, manage the product, and sell the product in return for ongoing royalty payments. It's about that simple. I will give you the right to manage this type of business, and you pay me a royalty.
Didn't you add to that, Marshall? Any?
Yeah, fundamentally, that's exactly what a franchise is, and a franchise is really a strategic partnership with the franchisor and the franchisee. And you know, a lot of times you'll hear the moniker "we're a family," and when I'm counseling with folks, I try to have them somewhat disregard that. This truly is a business relationship, and it's structured in such a way, and you need to understand that. Going in, that will be your strategic partner. You want to make sure that that's a partner you can work with and affiliate with and be happy with, because if you aren't, you're going to have, it's going to be a little difficult to get out of. So,
you're tied in. So it started with Singer. Can you tell us a little bit more about the history?
Well, Singer Sewing Machine in America was considered the first American company to start branding, as Roger said. I think really where franchising kind of present day came from was Ray Kroc when he created McDonald's. One of the things that Ray Kroc did that had been not done previous to him was he recognized that if a person was going to buy into a brand, one of the things that they needed, one of the things they were actually buying, was going to be a system. And you just can't give someone a name without the system in place to help them to be successful. And so he created kind of the business format concept, which is, I guess, maybe the business in the box, which is here's all the systems, the marketing, the operations, all the minutia of building a business. Here all of it is. Now, if we find the right person to be part of our system, they'll be the two or three final puzzle pieces that make the picture complete. So.
Well, Roger, tell us, how big is franchising in the United States, and what are some of the kinds of businesses besides restaurant?
That's an excellent question. As we'd mentioned, it started way back in the 50s, and clearly Ray Kroc and McDonald's brought it to the public recognition of franchising, even though it's been going on for eons prior to that. Actually, today, there are 760,000 franchises just in America itself, okay? Now, to put a perspective around that, that's nearly 10% of all of the private sector output in our economy.
Wow.
Okay, just to, again, give a more relative answer, it provides as well as over 10 million jobs to Americans just in the franchise system. But the statistic that I like to use the most, which brings it into the biggest size perspective for me, is that in America today, one out of every $3 that we all spend on a good or a service is spent in a franchised business.
Wow.
Now that number shocks a lot of people, but then you have to remind them, they buy gasoline, they stay in hotels and motels, they buy an automobile, they eat at a restaurant. But one out of every $3 spent on goods and services today is spent in a franchise. So it is a huge and vibrant part of our economy.
And most people, I know, think restaurants, but you were saying your gas and your lodging, and franchising is almost every industry, isn't it?
It covers over 75 industries today in America. There's virtually, name it, and there's probably a franchise involved in it.
Colleges?
Yes. Parochial education, for example, the Atlanta Art Institutes are basically a franchised operator. So the answer is yes.
Pretty much everything. Mm-hmm. Okay, well, it's big, and it's big business. So therefore, there's a lot of rules and regulations. Is that correct, Marshall?
I think it's important to understand that when you're buying into a franchise, you're buying into a system. And it's a system that someone else created, and if you become a franchisee, you become a partner in that system. But ultimately, the franchisor yields the power. And there's good and bad in that. It's important that there is a leader at that helm, because ultimately, the franchisor is building the brand. The bigger the brand is built, the more successful that brand is built with the franchisor and the franchisees, the more valuable your franchise license becomes. Ultimately, what I try to convey to folks when I'm doing workshops is that when you buy a franchise, typically the average owner owns that business about 7 years. So go into it with the mindset of you're going to buy it, you're going to build it, and you're going to sell it.
Okay, well, we've got a caller that wants to ask you a question on that. Caller, what is your question tonight?
Yeah, hi, my name is Jack, and the question I have, how much is it, the minimum should I accept in a franchise after deducting the expenses and the royalties and the advertisement fee? What's left in my hand, how much is the minimum should to make it worth the effort and all that? Example, is it 25% from the gross? Is it 30% from the gross? Or as minimum as 15% of the gross? That's the first segment that I have. The other, is it advisable to join a franchise owner association in any franchise business? Thank you.
Okay, so we got two questions there. The first is, what kind of net is it? What kind of percentage is it? 40%, 50%, 10%?
I really don't think that's an answerable question, because it depends on each of the franchise business opportunities. That's one of the reasons that we encourage when we counsel to, once you've matched yourself, to use Marshall's words, with the right franchise opportunity, it's very important to do, just as if you were starting a business from scratch, to do a financial pro forma which will answer those questions. But there is no rule of thumb that we can give you that say if you buy a franchise that your gross or your net is going to be a certain percentage.
Well, do they market performers with their packages, what they're selling?
Some franchise companies provide an earnings claim in their franchise disclosure document, which is in item 19 of that booklet that every franchise company has to provide to you. Most do not, though. That's how much you're going to make, your percentages, your ratios. You're going to validate that from the franchise owners. And even if the franchisor provides that information to you, you still want to validate it with someone that's been out there and has their money in the game, and because they can tell you the straight answer.
Yeah. It can vary to who's running the business.
Absolutely.
Where the business is. You can't predict the future, so if they say we do 20%.
You're always going to have people in the front, people in the middle, and people in the back.
Right, and I think, Marshall, correct me, but pretty much by law, the franchisor is precluded from saying they will generally say we can give you, without naming a big store example, a medium-sized store example, or a small store example, but there's way too many variables in their fixed cost, rent in in one area of the country is dramatically different than rent in another, okay? And rent frequently for a brick and mortar type franchise is one of the largest fixed expenses that they have to deal with.
So it's like any business.
Well,
let me ask you this. The other one I know people want to know is the cost. So Marshall, what would it cost me? Is it a gazillion dollars or can I get one for $10 a franchise?
Well, franchises, the investment ranges from as little as maybe $5,000 or $6,000 for some franchise license to millions. On average, about 52% of all franchise companies have investments of less than about $100,000.
That's less than I would have thought.
Yeah, I think that's the misnomer about franchising is we think of McDonald's, we think of Hardee's, we think of the Subways of the world, we think of some of the car rental companies, the hotels, and we just assume that everything's going to be, you know, millions and millions of dollars. And that's not the reality. I mean, probably 75-80% of them have investments of less than $250,000. That's franchise fee, that's working capital, that's all your licensing requirements. So it can be an affordable vehicle. But again, the key is not what it costs, it's what fits. Does it fit you? You know, I've sat down with a lot of people that could buy just about anything. And my mantra is, you know, let's find something that costs you the least, that fits you the best, and allows you to make the most.
And that's what both of you have warned me, is that too many people are just looking at what does it cost.
Yeah, Roger and I are definitely in concert on that.
That is absolutely the wrong place to start, particularly in many, many cases. Financing is involved to start a franchise business or to start a business from scratch. And the franchise that you buy, it's brand equity. I mean, not to use examples, but banks sometimes will be more willing to lend you more money behind a very strong brand than to lend you a small amount of money to a franchise that doesn't have a substantial, successful track record. So don't start with the financials.
Now, I know you work with both people that are going into their own business, starting their own business, or people buying a franchise. Which is better, start your own business from scratch or buy a franchise?
Well, there are pros and cons to starting your own business from scratch, okay, versus a franchise. The first advantage that I would say is frequently it's much less expensive or less expensive than to start a business from scratch. Okay. Mm-hmm. The other advantage of starting from scratch is picking up on something that Marshall has said is that you maintain, as starting from scratch, you can maintain complete independence and creative freedom. Okay. Franchises require you to be a process. Okay. That the very little creativity that that is tolerated. Now, the risk of starting from scratch versus a franchise opportunity are a number. The risk are it's a much higher rate of failure. Okay, whereas statistically 50 to 60% of all businesses started from scratch will fail within 5 years. I think the last statistic I read, approximately 75% of all new franchises succeed in that same period of time because they are buying the proven, demonstrated, successful model. Starting from scratch frequently means a longer period from startup to profitability, okay? And quite frankly, starting from scratch frequently, it's harder to obtain adequate financing or borrowings. Now, Marshall probably can add to what I've just said there.
Well, in franchising, I think there's very few true entrepreneurs in the world that one take their idea and run with it, have the staying power to create it, fund it, manage it, build it. Most people like being part of a system. They like the idea of implementing a system. They like the idea of getting profitable quickly. And that really fundamentally is what a franchise is. It's an implementation model, I believe. And if you are good at implementing and you find the right franchise system that fits your skill sets, then it can be a very successful marriage. if you are great at implementing and you purchase the wrong franchise, mm-hmm. it's going to be just as bad as starting something from scratch. It's not going to be a real nice day.
So if I came to you, how would you decide whether I should start from scratch or if I should be in a franchise, and which one should I be in if I should go in a franchise?
Most of my clients today are referred to me from all over Florida, from all over the country, et cetera. That being the case, there's automatically a little bit of the what do I do and how do I do it. The comfort level is a little bit higher because of the referral. The first step I'm going to do is have them fill out a franchise assessment profile. And that's a profile that we developed at FranNet in conjunction with Stanford University probably 2 decades ago. And we have updated that every year, and we feel it's pretty true to its task of helping us determine, at least initially, is this a person that's maybe good to look at any type of business? Okay. It may not necessarily franchising, but just general business in itself. So we'll start with that, and then we do something that's kind of old-fashioned in today's world. We actually will sit down with somebody face-to-face or do it by phone and get to know who they are and what they're trying to achieve from a financial perspective, from a personal goals, business goal perspective, etc. And we're doing all of that long before we even talk about a specific company. And so it's a lot of gathering of the sticks, so to speak, before we build the fire.
Well, you know, if I was starting it from scratch, I would recommend clients to have a relationship with an attorney, with an accountant, with an insurance agent, with a banker, all these proven professionals that know the elements I need to include when I'm starting my business from scratch. Do you advise the same thing with the
franchise? Well, I think that relationship, we kind of call it putting your professional team around you, whether you're starting from scratch, buying an existing business, or considering a franchise. Yes, at some point you will want to have you're an accountant, an insurance person, and a banker. But again, I think that's later in the stage. Okay, going back to Marshall's comment, deciding if franchising is right for you is the paramount first step. And let me be very clear: when I believe that franchising is not for everyone, okay, that's very important to understand that. No, it won't work for a lot of people, but it looks so easy to get into, but it's not for everyone. But yes, you have to at some point have your professional team with you, but none of that is going to replace or be a substitute for the personal due diligence that is required by you to make the business decision of, do I commit to this business or not? You know, after you've done your due diligence, you've gotten to that point where you're ready to commit. Now I think you can go surround yourself with the lawyer that's going to have to read the franchise agreement or the Uniform Franchise Offering Circular, the accountant that may help you structure your company in terms of its incorporation, the insurance man, which is so often neglected, okay? To make sure that you have the right liability insurance, depending on what your business is. Are you touching people? Are you teaching classes with moving parts? So at the right time, you should have your professional team.
We have another caller.
Okay.
Caller, what is your question tonight?
For a retail business.
Okay, the question about the inventory on a retail business?
They're talking about franchises, and they have an automated everything set up, a system of doing things. And I'm wondering how to get that in for my business, how to barcode and have things organized to where I can ring it up and it automatically goes into a system that's already accounted for.
So if you got a franchise, you were talking about systems and processes. I would assume that the inventory, the coding, the pricing, all of that's established, right?
There are good franchises, and there are great franchises, and there are bad franchises.
Not so maybe.
So, yeah, I mean, and that, as Roger has said a few times, and I concur with that 100%, it goes back to your due diligence. I mean, depending on your risk ratio, I mean, if you were to buy a McDonald's, there's not a lot of risk really associated with that. It's a pretty proven method of business that seems to work quite nicely for the people that are their owners. Doesn't mean there aren't issues, but it's pretty systematized.
But they already have all the inventory.
Everything
they have all
is
that
everything
out.
Is done. But younger franchise companies, they have some. They still are on that learning curve, I believe.
And yeah, I think to the caller's question, because I heard the word retail. If I were investigating or researching franchise opportunities, I certainly would expect a retail franchisor. That's part of the franchise fee. That's part of the system that you're buying. The point of sale machine. That ties into the inventory and the inventory processing, even to the point of knowing product flows and automatic reorderings. In other words, that's what you're buying when you buy a franchise. That's, you're skipping all of that build it yourself, and you're buying those proven established. That's what the franchise fee is for. So part of your due diligence, caller, is to make sure if you're considering a retail franchise,
they're a great one that has that.
That they have that, and that right. In your due diligence in talking to existing franchisees, does it work?
Mm-hmm. Okay, or do they overcharge you, overload you, delay getting the inventory to you, or are they helping you be successful? Because it's to their advantage that you're successful.
Absolutely.
Right? I mean, they need you to do well. I mean, that helps everybody.
The only way they will grow is by validation.
Now, I heard the first caller asking a question about associations. Isn't there an IFA, mm-hmm. International Franchise Association, and groups that you can become a member in or something?
Go ahead.
That's a double-edged sword. There are the International Franchise Association, and their webpage is franchise.org. There are those kinds of associations. Now, if you're thinking of buying a franchise and they have a franchise organization among the current franchisees, mm-hmm. You want to ask the question of why. Okay. Now, frequently it's all for very legitimate reasons that they share ideas,
promotion.
Right. Promotion. Mm-hmm. But again, they cannot operate outside the purview of the franchisor. But frequently you got to find out what that's for, because that may in fact be a group of franchisees that have an issue with mm-hmm. the franchisor.
Mm-hmm.
So be careful with that one. Okay.
Okay, we're going to run out of time. I want to real quickly touch a couple of things. Roger, I want to find out if people were interested in franchising, how could they talk to you? What do you do? How do you help them? What's going on with the SBDC?
Well, they can call the SBDC, any of them in their area, and we have counselors in all of our offices that are equipped to deal with prospective franchisees. And primarily what we assist you in doing is, again, going to Marshall's point, helping you understand what your desires are, matching that with the right franchise opportunity, helping you select a good franchise within that opportunity, and then pretty much mentor you through the due diligence as well as the financial forecasting process to put you in a position to be able to make the right decision when the time comes.
Now, you talked about referrals. Can they contact you, or do they have to be referred? And if they do, what happens?
They absolutely can contact me. They can send me an email, and my email address is mready@frannet.com. They can go to our website, frannet.com. But when someone contacts me, we're going to have a conversation. I need to get a little better a feel of who they are, what they're trying to accomplish here. Again, I don't believe business ownership is the right vehicle for everybody. And so you need to kind of extrapolate that from that conversation. Mm-hmm. Assuming that the conversation goes in a positive manner, then the next step is to email them a copy of our franchise assessment profile, and then once we get that back, it kind of starts the process of going down that road of discovery, so to speak. So.
Well, the whole purpose of this show really is to make people aware that there are opportunities, that there is information out there, there are people to help them. I would love to see people that were looking at this or starting from scratch, whatever, interested in business, improving how they're doing in business, to get in touch with people that are available. There's so many resources out there to help people. And we need to take advantage of it. I mean, it's so sad when I see people fail, and all they had to have done was, prior to that, contacted some people, get some help, and work together. Well, Marshall and Roger, thank you for joining our show and sharing how to succeed in the franchise arena. For business training or planning assistance, visit your local SBDC or www.floridasbdc.com. Thank you for watching, and we'll see you next week on the Small Business Hotline.